Hello everyone, in my last few videos we are talking about arrays. We are talking about arrays of simple dipoles. We have made two element array, we have made broadside and end fire array using 4NEC2 software. In my last video we have made four element array also, and using 4NEC2 we have seen their working, their radiation pattern, etc. It is a thing to be observed that when we increase the number of elements in an array, its radiation pattern changes in such a way that the directivity increases. And in this diagram we can see that the 4 element array has a very good directivity at 90 degree and 270 degree. By the way, this is a broadside array. And we can also see that as compared to a 2 element array, the 4 element array has 4 minor lobes, side lobes. And when we increase the number of elements from 4 to 6, so that we have increase in gain, we can see that the again minor lobes are increased from 4 to 8. And again if we increase the number of elements, again the minor lobes increase. The kind of increase exponentially, because now there are 12 minor lobes that I can count. So there is no as such count that we can predict that how many minor lobes will come, but they are irritating, they are unnecessary, and they will waste the energy that is provided to the antenna. So now we can conclude that a uniform linear array has an advantage that if we increase the number of elements, it will increase the directivity, but it will also increase the side lobes. So let us understand that why these minor lobes and side lobes are appearing. See, imagine that these four elements are making a broadside array. So I have named them element number 1, 2, 3 and 4. So if we ignore 3 and 4 and see only 1 and 2 elements, antenna elements, we can say that these two elements will radiate together and the radiation patterns will constructively interfere at 90 degree and 270 degree from the plane of this array. But if you imagine that as the number of elements are increased, the radiation pattern from the edge elements, when they interfere with each other, their fundamental harmonics will never interfere. And we know that as electromagnetic waves travel, their amplitude attenuates. So we can say that the edge elements, when they interfere, they will not be at their peak of the amplitude. So the higher harmonics, when they interfere with each other, they anyways will give minor lobes, and since they are having less amplitude, they will worse the conditions. So that is why we are seeing here more and more minor lobes as the number of elements are increasing. Why? Because the larger array has the edge elements more and farther apart from each other, and they will worsen the conditions of this interference. So the best thing would be that rather than giving the same amplitude to all of them, see, I remind you that in a uniform linear array, all the elements, these 1, 2, 3 and 4, they are all fed with the same amplitude. But the problem that the center elements, when their radiation pattern goes towards the edge, it attenuates and they don't interfere with that much intensity. But we can solve it by giving more amplitude to the center elements, and by giving less amplitude to the edge elements, what we can see, we can achieve that the radiation pattern from these edge elements will not interfere with each other. Means this one radiation pattern from 1 and radiation pattern from 4 will not interfere with each other, so that will also solve the problem and will not result in minor lobes. So I have already discussed the solution, but to make this solution possible, few scientists and few mathematicians played their role. One of them is Jay Stone. He gave the proposal of tapered array. Tapered array means in a linear array, what we do that we supply the central elements with some higher amplitude, and as we go towards the edge, we keep on reducing the supplied amplitude to the element. One such array is binomial array. Binomial array was proposed by Mr. J. Stone, and in this array, to find out the amplitude to be supplied to the array elements, we follow a binomial series. In order to give more amplitude at the center and keep on reducing the amplitude at the edges, we needed some rule. So binomial series gave us that rule. What is done here that each term has a coefficient in binomial series. These coefficients are used to calculate the amount of amplitude to be provided to the array elements. We'll see this in next slide how it is done. See, let us consider that this is the sample series that we saw in the last slide. Let us imagine that the small n is the number of elements in this expression. If we keep small n as 2, this a plus b will be raised to power 1 only. So this left hand side will be only a plus b. So if we calculate the right hand side, you can see that this also will result in only a plus b. Let us consider that a is one term and b is another term. So a singly will have a coefficient 1 and b also has a coefficient 1. So we will put here 1 and 1 because a and b has no constant coefficients. So we will consider them as 1. Similarly, if we put n is equals to 3, in left hand side this will become 3 minus 1, that means a plus b square. We know that the formula for a plus b whole square is a square plus 2ab plus b square. If we put the value of n in these three terms, we will get the same value. So a square has coefficient 1, 2ab has coefficient 2 and b square has coefficient 1. So if the number of elements to be used are 3, we have to give the central element 2 voltage and the edge elements 1 voltage each. And if we keep the value of n as 4, we can see that the first coefficient will remain 1, the second coefficient will become 3 minus 1, that means 4 minus 1, that means 3, and here it will again become 3 if you calculate, and the last one will become again 1. So if you substitute these values of n, eventually you see that only first n terms are being used. And in this table we can see that these terms are showing the number of elements, as this small n is also showing the number of elements. So one thing we should note, that these values that we calculated are not exact voltages that we are going to supply to our array elements. This is just the voltage ratio. Okay, so in my previous videos I have made uniform linear array of three elements, not three elements, we made of two elements and four elements. So four element array, if we try to make a four element array which is a binomial array, we have to use this third row, which is 1 3 3 1. So in a uniform linear array we supplied all the four elements with one voltage each, and if I make a binomial array of four elements, I have to give the central two elements 3 voltage and the edge elements as 1 volt. So these are the few points about the comparison between the binomial array and uniform array. The first point is that the binomial array will have non-uniform supplies as compared to uniform array, which has equal supply to all the elements. And if we make a binomial array, it is guaranteed that you will not get no side lobes, no minor lobes. And if we increase the number of elements in a uniform array, the directivity becomes very good, beam width becomes very thin. But as compared to uniform array, the binomial array has not that much thinner beam width as it was in uniform array. We'll see. And the only disadvantage with the binomial array is that the amplitude distribution becomes very impractical. Let's go back again and see. See, if you can see this triangle, this is something known as Pascal triangle, if you notice. the bottom element is the addition of two above elements, like 1 plus 1 is 2 here. Then this 3 is coming because 1 plus 2 is 3. And this, if we go down, this 4 plus 6 is 10. So, you can see that if the number of elements are increased, you will get very big values at the center. It might go for 10 elements, it might go up to 3 digits or something like that. So, here, to make a binomial array in a tool like MATLAB or Scilab, we need an array factor. In uniform linear array, we have already seen that there is something known as array factor, and it is a trigonometrical identity, and we used it to draw the radiation pattern in a polar plot. So if we want to draw a polar plot using MATLAB or Scilab, this array factor that we need of a binomial array is here shown as cos psi by 2 whole raised to power n minus 1, where n are the number of elements. This, in this slide, the left hand side is the radiation pattern of 4 element uniform linear array. We have already seen it, but let us compare it with a binomial array radiation pattern. We can see that the directivity is good as compared to the binomial array in the right hand side. The beam width is a little bit thicker than the uniform linear array. But here we have minor lobes, and here there are no minor lobes. So theoretically, a binomial array promises that you will get no minor lobes if you follow the method of giving amplitude the same as it was recommended by the scientist J. Stone. Now that we have learned the theory of binomial array, let us try making a 4-element binomial array. So before jumping to the software, let us first see that how to make it in the form of dimensions and locations. In my previous video, I have already discussed how to make a 4-element uniform array. I am using the same diagram and the same explanation here. So those who have not seen that video, I will recommend you to see it because it will help you understand this in a better way. Anyways, I am again explaining it. See, there are 4 elements and they are placed at 0.5 lambda away from each other, and their lengths are 0.46 lambda because they are supposed to be a simple dipole each. I have named the center 2 elements 1 and 2 and the outer 2 elements 3 and 4. To place them in this way, in 4NEC2 software, you need to give them some starting and ending coordinates, and I have given them like this. So L is their length. We'll use this variable small l there in software as well, and we'll use this small d, the distance between these elements there. So L by 2, D by 2, then minus L by 2, D by 2, 0. These are starting coordinate and ending coordinate of the first antenna. This is for the second antenna. This is for the third antenna. And this is nothing but plain three-dimensional geometry. That's how I am doing it. And I am not getting into detail of this because these dimensions are exactly the same as the 4-element uniform array. Only difference between a uniform array and a binomial array is just the supply. So the change of supply I am explaining here down here. So as we have seen the Pascal triangle thing there in the slide, if the 4 elements are to be used, the center 2 elements should have the supply 3 volt. My mistake, the center elements I have named them as 1 and 2. So 1 and 2 should have 3 volt. And 3 and 4, because they are outer elements, they should have 1 volt each. So this is the correct way of supplying them. According to my naming convention, the center elements were 1 and 2. So I should give 1 and 2 as 3 volt, because my target was to give 1, 3, 3 and 1 as the voltages to these elements. Since I have already made a 4-element uniform array, and I hope that the people, those who have followed my last video, they have also made it, I am using the same file to make a binomial array. I will just make changes. So this is my file that is already opened. This was n-element uniform array. I will just open the editor. In this editor, see the symbols, they are same. The small l is 0.49. I changed it because the resonant frequency was shifted a little bit. In my last video, I have changed it. So it won't matter. You can change it anytime if you see that the resonant frequency is not matching. So from 0.46 to 0.5, you can vary it, this small l, the value of small l. The d, small d, which is the spacing, that has to be same. Because in binomial array, you have to space them equally. And also, you can make only a broadside radiation pattern in a binomial array. So this file should be matching with the broadside 4 element array. So let's go to geometry. See, the geometry should exactly be the same the way it was in broadside 4 element array. So because I am opening the same file that I already made to make a broadside 4 element array, I am not changing this geometry even a single bit. Those who want to note it down, they can pause the video right now and they can fill it. These x1, y1 and z1, x2, y2 and z2 are the starting and ending coordinates of these antennas 1, 2, 3 and 4. As we have planned, the 1 and 2 are the central elements. We'll remember it and we'll supply this 1 and 2 with 3 volt and this 3 and 4 antenna numbers to be supplied with 1 volt each. So let us go to the source load. In the source load, 1 and 2, see, if you go here, you can see that these are the central elements by the dimension only you can notice it. So we are sure about it. So let's go to source load and make these voltages as 3 volt and 3 volt each. 3 volt each. And these element number 3 and 4, you can see that they have already have 1 volt. So we'll save it and run the simulation. See, the radiation pattern that we can see here is like a figure of 8, and this is the radiation pattern which was expected by a binomial array, and we can press space bar and see that how it is radiating. And by looking at its three-dimensional radiation pattern, we'll get to know more that how does it look. See, this is the radiation pattern of a binomial array. We can rotate it around and we can see that here four elements are still being used, but if you remember that there are two ear lobe shaped minor lobes which were present in four element uniform array. These are not present here. You can also notice that four element uniform broadside array had the directivity 9.07. And directivity is a little bit reduced in binomial array. So at the cost of reduce in directivity, we can remove the side lobes in binomial array. But we have already seen its disadvantages, that here there are only 4 elements, so the central element is having 3 voltage. But if you increase the number of elements, the central elements may have 64 volt or 128 volts, so it might increase, and it might increase so impractically that it is impossible to make it in real life, because these are not exactly the voltages. Because we are simulating it, so we are actually giving 1 volt, 3 volt and 3 volt. If somebody wants to scale it up to increase the power, they have to multiply all the voltages by, let's say, 5 volt. So this edge elements will become 5 volt. And these two central elements will become 5 threes of 15 volt. So it will become 5, 15, 15 and 5. Understood? So what I am trying to say, that binomial array theory gives us just the ratio of amplitudes. They won't give us the exact amplitude. So this ratio becomes impractical. So that is why binomial array is only preferred when you are trying to make a small array and you are very desperate about removing the minor lobes. So that's it about the explanation of binomial array. In my next video, I'll try to come up with another array, and in this series of 4 NEC2 tutorial, my target is to nearly complete all the types of linear array that are there in undergraduate antenna syllabus. So thank you.